Please welcome IRF Summit co-chair, Katrina Lantos Swett.
Thank you so much. It's wonderful to be with all of you. I hope you're having a fantastic lunch. We just had the opportunity to hear about some of the remarkable work of the International Center for Law and Religion Studies, and I want to point out that ICLRS has been an incredible partner in the IRF Summit from almost the very beginning. And in many ways, it really has been a forerunner of the entire IRF movement. Nearly a quarter century ago, Cole Durham and his fellow travelers conceived of an idea of establishing this center. And as you've heard, it had a simple and a vast mission to help secure the blessings of religious liberty for all. At the plenary opening today, I spoke about the iconic film Field of Dreams and how the main character felt called to do something very improbable, to build a baseball diamond smack dab in the middle of an Iowa cornfield. He was told, if you build it, they will come. And they did. Well, the outstanding people from BYU have built the International Center for Law and Religion Studies smack dab in the middle of the Wasatch Mountains. And they have built a real jewel, maybe we might even say a diamond, of the global IRF movement. And people, in fact, have come from every corner of the world to learn, to network, to research, to instruct and to learn, and to provide really sort of the intellectual heft and inspirational fire to advance the cause of freedom of religion and belief for everyone, everywhere. It makes perfect sense that they would do this, because the recognition and honoring of our inalienable right to possess our own souls and to freely choose to follow our conscience where it leads is central to the beliefs of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And it is a tribute, I think, to that community's breadth of vision and the spirit of brotherhood that characterizes it, that they have built this admired and respected institution dedicated to the fight that we are all engaged in. So I want to thank the International Center and all of those of you who are here from ICLRS for hosting this wonderful lunch. And I want to thank you for what you have done. And I have to, in particular, of course, call out Cynthia and Dennis Lang, who have been part of this effort and have done so much to sort of bring the center and the IRF Summit together in such a wonderful way. We are in for an unbelievable treat today because, as you may know, BYU produces some of the most talented performers in our great country. And today, we are going to have the exceptional experience of being serenaded by Oyoyo Joi Bonner. Oyoyo is one of eight children to hero parents. She is a talented musician and currently is starring on Broadway in Moulin Rouge, the musical. Her additional Broadway credits include MJ the Musical, The Book of Mormon. She has also appeared as Mary of Bethany in the film adaptation The Lamb of God, and was the executive producer of the film Green Flake. She is a BYU alumni of that exceptional performing arts program. She is delightful. She exudes charm and charisma and talent, and we are in for just an exceptional treat. And she is going to be accompanied by the talented Brayden Walters. So please join me in welcoming our entertainment and performer for today, Oyoyo Joi Bonner.
Thank you. Crossing to the other side. We are pilgrims on a journey through the darkness of the night. We are bound for other places, crossing to the other side. I will worry about tomorrow, when tomorrow comes in sight. Until then, I'm just a pilgrim crossing to the other side. Jesus will be there to meet me. He will take his hand in mine. I will when I reach the other side.
to remember Thank you. Thank you.
Aren't they incredible? Oh, so much talent and a lot of love flowing out too. That was really very, very special. It's now my privilege to introduce to you an outstanding panel that will be addressing a really interesting and relevant topic. The topic of their discussion will be a United Nations Human Dignity Day, an idea whose time has come. And I am so eager to hear what this outstanding panel has to say. When Brett Scharffs first shared with me this idea of establishing a Human Dignity Day and sort of underscoring how dignity lies at the very heart of the entire human rights movement, it really is the pillars on which the whole architecture rests. I remembered an ad for granola from many, many years ago when granola was kind of a new thing and there were all different brands coming out, and then Quaker Oats came out with the best brand of granola. And they had an ad campaign that said, "Quaker Oats, we found the recipe that everyone else missed." And I thought, oh my gosh, you know, that is what it feels like with this idea of focusing the world's attention on a Human Dignity Day. It's the right recipe for what we need now to remind us what drives and motivates the human rights movement. So without further ado, I'd like to ask the panel members to come up. Our moderator is going to be Brett Scharffs. Brett is the Rex E. Lee Chair and Professor of Law at Brigham Young University's J. Reuben Clark Law School, and he directs the International Center for Law and Religion Studies. He will be joined by Ján Figeľ, a former EU Commissioner and Deputy Prime Minister of Slovakia. He also served as a Vice President of the Slovak Parliament and was the first ever Special Envoy for the Promotion of Religion or Belief, religion and belief outside the EU. They will also be joined by Dr. Ewelina Ochab, an esteemed lawyer, human rights advocate, and author. She works as the program lawyer with the International Bar Association's Human Rights Institute and is co-founder of the Coalition for Genocide Response. And finally, Mark Hill, a British barrister who specializes in ecclesiastical law and religious liberty. He has been involved in litigation in the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom, the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg, and the Supreme Court of the United States of America. Please join me in welcoming these distinguished panelists and give them your attention. Thank you so much. Come on up, gentlemen. Oh, they're here. Wonderful.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Brett Scharffs, and we're so grateful to have this opportunity to talk to you about the United Nations Human Dignity Day proposal, an idea whose time has come. We, along with many other people, have been focusing on human dignity for the last 5 years. One of the milestones in that work was the Punta del Este Declaration on Human Dignity for Everyone Everywhere. And another milestone is this year in commemoration of the 75th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We've been engaged in major book projects on Asian perspectives of human dignity, African perspectives on human dignity, and Islamic perspectives on human dignity. Our goal is not to find an imperial definition, rather our goal is to listen to each other about what human dignity means to us. And the metaphor we have been using is that these different understandings and insights are points of light, like stars in the night sky, that collectively will illuminate us so that we can do our work and travel our journey here on Earth. The 75th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was celebrated on December 10th. 2023. And each December 10th is Human Rights Day. And our goal is to try to encourage the United Nations to create a companion celebration on June 10th, which would be Human Dignity Day. And In the very near future, we will have a core group of countries introduce this resolution in the United Nations, and our hope is that this will be adopted through broad consensus globally. Now, we didn't begin our lunch with a prayer, which we probably should have done here at the Religious Freedom Summit. The chair of the committee that drafted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was Eleanor Roosevelt. And I'd like to begin our panel today by just reading you Eleanor Roosevelt's nightly prayer. When I hear this, it makes me a little embarrassed about what my nightly prayers sometimes consist in. This is what Eleanor prayed each night. Our Father, who has set a restlessness in our hearts and made us all seekers after that which we can never fully find, forbid us to be satisfied with what we make of life. Draw us from base content and set our eyes on far-off goals. Keep us at tasks too hard for us, that we may be driven to thee for strength. Deliver us from fretfulness and self-pitying. Make us sure of the good we cannot see and of the hidden good in the world. Open our eyes to simple beauty all around us and our hearts to the loveliness men hide from us because we do not try to understand them. Save us from ourselves and show us a vision of the world made new. Our panelists have already been introduced, and we'd like to focus on two questions, and I'm going to ask each of our panelists to address them. The first question is why? Why, with a UN calendar so full of dates and commemorations, why do we need one more? What is the reason for us to have a Human Dignity Day? And Ewelina, let me start with you.
Thank you very much, Brett. Over recent months, I've been working with British politicians on the topic of gender apartheid of Iranian and Afghani women and girls. And there is a massive campaign behind it as well here in the US. And one of the things that the campaigners always say is that we need as many tools in the toolkit as possible. And this is precisely the same with our work and the work to establish the UN Day on Human Dignity. We need yet another tool to make sure that we can implement human rights for everyone everywhere. We can ensure human dignity for everyone everywhere. And also, I have a wonderful quote from Eleanor Roosevelt as well, from her speech from 1951, commenting on the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And she said that in each generation and in each country, there must be a continuation of the struggle. And new steps forward must be taken, since this is preeminently a field in which to stand still is to retreat. And this is exactly the motivation behind establishing this day. We, over recent years, we've seen how communities around the world, individuals around the world, are persecuted because of their religion or belief, because of their political position, and so on. And we need a change in the society, and it could indeed start with greater education on human dignity, and of course, taking yet another step to ensure that we do more to protect human dignity of everyone, everywhere.
Thank you. Well, anytime someone quotes Eleanor Roosevelt, I'm bound to be in agreement. So thank you for that, Ewelina. Jan, what would you add to the question, why do we need yet another United Nations Day?
Thank you very much for this opportunity, and I'm grateful for this, not auditorium, but community, which shares so much and also commitment for, I believe, to make our times more humane. When I am getting older, I always remember my dream that 21st century would be more humane time. I have doubts, but my commitment remains, and this is the answer. Human Dignity Day can educate us more about the roots of our rights which are important because my dignity means I have my rights inviolable, inalienable, but I have also my duties, which are inalienable as father, as husband, as citizen of my country, and citizen of this world. This is very important balance, duties and rights, freedom and responsibility. And dignity represents this balance. Imago Dei, Karama, very important understanding of dignity given by Creator. If there is a place or point, philosophical or human point, where religious and secular humanists and people in general should get together, meet together, understand each other, it is dignity of all and for all. We are all equal in dignity. This is the message of the UDHR for 75 years. Do you see it in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, in China, in North Korea, or any countries? I don't want to specify, but this is important message. We are all equal in dignity, and it should be translated into socio-political principle. We are all equal under law. Not first-class citizens and second-class citizens, majorities, minorities, all equal. And therefore, because there are gaps in this mosaic on equality and dignity, we need to contribute to this. And I think that Human Dignity Day could learn us about the fact of dignity, because dignity is a fact. It's not given by state, by organization. It's something what we are endowed. And this forum and fora like Abu Dhabi Peace Forum or other organizations could help to promote this culture of human dignity. Why? My last argument is there is deep and strong nexus between human dignity and religious freedom. You all know maybe to quote even Article 18, which speaks about freedom of thought, conscience, and religion, which speaks in one language about our rationality, morality, and religiosity, in one, for all, believers, non-believers. And Article 1, which one could say of the UDHR, is the most humane beginning of everything, speaks that we are all endowed with reason, conscience, and should behave in the spirit of brotherhood. So this nexus between religious freedom and human dignity is there objectively, and it's for us to implement it, to translate it into life, into relations, and therefore Human Dignity Day for all.
Thank you, Jan. Mark, what would you add?
I would simply add one point about the practical outworkings of human dignity. And I expect it's a point that everyone in this room is already alive to, because the great joy of this summit is that there is a youth stream engaging with the next generation who are going to come forward and fight for issues of freedom of religion and human dignity. Of course, human dignity should be in the forefront of our minds every day of the year. But by declaring a United Nations Human Dignity Day, it gives a point of focus for schools and educational establishments the world over, where they can inculcate in our young the benefits and the advantages of showing dignity to one another, in valuing one another because of our innate worth as individuals. And that will be fostered through PACs and teaching aids and materials that will bring home what it means to understand what human dignity is all about. And just as every year we get our diaries and our calendars already pre-populated with national days, with religious holidays and the rest, I dream that amongst all of those days, as an essential part of the arc of the year, will be a 24-hour period when every educational establishment the world over can focus on the enormous benefits of seeing the world through the prism of human dignity.
Thank you, Mark. So, Ewelina, a tool, an additional tool in our toolbox as we promote human rights. Jan, helping us to see the link between rights and duties. And Mark, helpfully focusing on education and the importance of preserving these rights by passing them forward to the rising generations. I'm going to ask each of our panelists to briefly, just in 1 minute, address a second question, and then we'll be done. And that is, what can we do here, this group? We believe that the people sitting in this ballroom today are really influential and can make a defining difference in whether this effort is successful or not. So we hope that each of you will be thinking about, what can I do to lift where I stand to help advance the cause of human dignity for all and religious freedom for all? So let's just go in reverse order. Mark, let's start with you. What do you imagine or hope that the people in this room can do to help this effort?
Well, having spoken about the grassroots of education, we need to engage at a much higher level in order to get traction in the UN Human Dignity Day. And I think it's important to make one single solid argument about the advantage that that can bring. The United Nations is riven with division. We see this daily in our newspapers with Gaza and with the Ukraine. There are forces in the world that push us apart. They are centrifugal in that way. What human dignity can offer is a concept around which we can all gather and around which we can agree. Brett has said this project has been ongoing for 5 years. In all that time, I've never heard anyone say that valuing human dignity is a bad thing or not worth doing. There is a unity of spirit, there is a unity of aspiration. And once we focus on what connects and unites and brings us together, then hopefully we can engage the political forces, the diplomatic forces, and those that work at the UN at its central point to push hard to get a consensus among nations to bring this day into fruition.
Thanks, Mark. Jan, what would you hope that the people here today can do to help?
Everybody has some opportunities, some tools, some possibilities, and everybody has responsibility to make our living more humane. So, for example, for IRF Summit and for IRF Secretariat, which I support, is to include Human Dignity Day and dignity culture into its messages, like covenantal pluralism as well, because it helps then to unite people around this stream or efforts. Abu Dhabi Forum for Peace will be presented here with Virtues, Alliance of Virtues. I think dignity unites us civilizationally, whole world, if we want to see something as common ground, common future, common victory. It's human dignity. And last not least, Alliance, which was established, has some representatives here. I don't want to name anybody, but it could embrace human dignity as part of defense of religious freedom because of there is nexus. And it's important that message for people in Nigeria, Nicaragua, Japan, democracies as well, that dignity for all matters for all and means equal citizenship for all. Thank you.
Ewelina, the final word to you.
We started with Eleanor Roosevelt and we'll conclude with her as well. And she asked once, where after all do universal human rights begin? And her answer was, in small places, close to home. And this is precisely what I would like attendees to do, to take the message of human dignity back home and to make sure that they incorporate this important message into their work. And that includes, of course, education on human dignity and human rights and the nexus, but making sure that human dignity becomes really a part of your everyday work and everyday life. Thank you.
Thank you. So in order for a United Nations General Assembly resolution to pass, it needs a majority of all the countries who belong to the United Nations to vote for it. Our hope is that this will become a consensus effort that will generate near unanimity. Let me ask you to join me in thanking Oyoyo Joi Bonner for her performance here at lunch today. Join me in thanking Sam Brownback and Katrina Lantos Swett and all of the people who worked tirelessly with them to make this event possible, and to also thank our panelists, Mark Hill, Ján Figeľ, and Ewelina Ochab. Thank you.
Please exit the ballroom so we can begin preparations for the next event.